You in the Christmas spirit yet? The snow's falling.
I'm getting there.
Look, it's beginning to look a lot like it.
I think we should do Christmas.
I love Christmas. We need to get in the spirit a little bit.
I know.
Bit.
We do.
Maybe we should go out and carol.
Carol.
Okay. Or, better yet,
yes.
Let's make other people carol to us.
I actually love that idea. But,
you know what my favorite Christmas song is? Christmas Carol? This is real. You'd think it'd be a classic, like a Silent Night or, you know, Rudolph. Here we go, ready? I wanna wish you a Merry Christmas from the bottom. A little spicy Christmas.
Feliz Navidad.
Prospero año
felicidad. I love Christmas carols.
Hey, you crazy elves. What are you doing on my property?
Come on and sing for us.
Sing?
It's Christmas time.
Okay. We can do that. Frosty the snowman was a happy frosty man. Help me, elf, because I don't know the lyrics.
He had a corn cob pipe
and a button nose and two eyes made out of coal. Frosty the snowman.
Silent night, holy night, all is calm, all is bright. Round yon virgin's mother.
Christmas carols are good things, right?
Oh yeah.
You know what, you know, like what they, the new, the modern day Scrooge is?
What?
A Christmas Karen. Christmas Karen. 2020's been a bad year, but
might have been the worst year for Karens.
Yeah, Karens.
It's beginning to look a lot like Christmas.
Okay.
You better not shout, you better not cry,
you better not
perfect pout, I'm telling you why, cause Santa Claus is coming to town.
Aw, brilliant!
I'm practicing for this year, I'm gonna be in the church choir. This is my jingle bells.
Jingle bells, jingle bells, jingle all the way. Oh,
what
fun it is
to ride in a one. Hold on. He said the best way to spread Christmas cheer is singing loud for all to hear.
Rudolph, with your nose so bright, won't you drive by sleigh tonight? Then all the reindeer loved him.
Shout it out with glee.
Rudolph the red-nosed reindeer,
reindeer,
you'll go down in history.
All right, get off my property.
Excellent job. Excellent.
All right. Merry Christmas.
All right. What's up, One City? How are you guys doing? Everybody hanging in there? Doing all right? I'm overjoyed to be with you in person, those of you watching online. Grateful to be with you online. We are One City Church, bringing hope and purpose to everyone, and bringing the hope and purpose of Jesus to everyone. And so we're in a new series called Carols, and the reason that we decided to do a series called Carols was that around 320 AD was when the Christmas holiday became an official Christian holiday, okay? So it was 300 years after the resurrection of Jesus that it became a holiday, and around that time, that was when vespers and hymns started to be written about the birth of Jesus, about the coming of Jesus, and about his wonderful birth on that amazing, fateful night, right? And so, so some of these carols that we sing around Christmas time, they're not just hundreds of years old. Some of them are over 1,000 years old. For example, this one is only hundreds of years old, but O come ye, God Rest Ye Merry Gentlemen was written in the 1700s, and the song that we just sang, O Come Emmanuel, was written in the 8th century. Some people think the 12th century, okay? But hundreds of years old, and these carols are rich with, like, deep theology and nuance, and their lyrics tell us about what Jesus did, what he came to do, his birth. If you are celebrating this Advent season, Just amazing. And so we thought, well, let's get into the Christmas spirit, not just by singing Mariah Carey, although that's awesome. I'm all about it. Not just by singing Justin Bieber, although yes, that will happen, but by singing carols that have this amazing, rich context to them. And I was thinking, it's amazing that we get together here in person. We're only allowed to gather with just a couple people in the room, but it's so wonderful regardless. But I was thinking about, and the topic that we want to talk to you about tonight is this idea of loneliness around the holidays. It used to be a few months ago, right, when we would get together in a place like this or in churches around America, and we would be able to gather and we would be able to worship our God and we would be able to spend time with one another, and it would make us feel as though we weren't so alone, yeah, in our faith. It would make us feel as though we weren't so alone in our life. But it's been a bit of a different year. It's been a lonely year, right? And I remembered seeing some of my friends' Instagram posts pop up, and because of the pandemic, because of what we're experiencing right now, people would post pictures of themselves, and they would be on walks by themselves, or they would be eating by themselves. It's been a lonely kind of a year. And I think if you guys know John and I, we are very excited. We love parties. John and I, your lead pastors, love parties. We love parties where you dress up. We love parties where you dress down. We love Christmas sweater parties, maybe both. You could do both if you wanted. We love parties where you play games and it's just a couple people. We love dance parties especially, but we can't do that at all this year. It's just a different year. It's a lonely year. And in 1948, there was a Christmas song that was written, and it was written by J.W. Johnson, and he wrote it on the way back from Connecticut, on the commuter train, back from New York City to Connecticut, and he was thinking about this idea of being alone at the holidays, of being alone at Christmas. And it was first performed by Doyle O'Dell, which, what a name. He for sure is a country artist, amen. And it was first performed by Doyle O'Dell, and then it was made famous by Elvis Presley in 1958. And it is a song called Blue Christmas, and we're going to listen to it right now. So check this out.
It being the time of year that it is, I'd like to do my favorite Christmas song of all the ones I've recorded.
I'll have a blue Christmas. I'll be so blue just thinking about you. Decorations of red on a green Christmas tree won't be the same day if you're not here.
All right, so Martina McBride actually wasn't alive then. I watched it, and it kind of tripped me out. I was like, wait a second. If you guys know who Martina McBride, she's like 52 now, okay? And I was watching it. I was very confused. And John was like, it's a blue screen, Jess. It's a blue screen. I was like, oh, okay, you know, like easily fooled. I was so confused by this video. But the original video is of Elvis singing. I think it's somewhere in the 60s. He was the original Justin Bieber. For those of you who don't know, okay, there will come a point in time where we'll be hanging out, and we're going to be talking about how much we love Justin Timberlake. We love Justin Bieber, and everyone that is younger than us is going to be like, what? That's weird. As a lot of us just experienced just then, he does his lip thing, and I like can't hang. I don't even know what he's doing with his lips and his eyebrows at the same time. But listen, those girls, you could tell they loved him, did they not? All right? But what Elvis is singing about is this thought of being away from the ones that you love at Christmas, right? About it being a lonely Christmas. And so if you have your Bibles or if you have your phones, go ahead, and we're going to be in Genesis 2, and then we're going to be in Luke 2. And so we're going to be in the creation count at the beginning of creation, and then we are also going to be visiting the beginning of the birth of Jesus. And so we're going to start in Luke 2. It says this: in those days, Caesar Augustus issued a decree that a census should be taken throughout the entire Roman world. This was the first census that took place while Quirinius was the governor of Syria. And everyone went to their own town to register. So Joseph went up from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to Bethlehem, to the town of David, because he belonged to the house of David, in the line of David. And he went there and he registered with Mary, who was pledged to be married to him and was expecting a child. While they were there, the time came for the baby to be born, and she gave birth to her firstborn, a son. And she wrapped him in clothes and placed him in the manger because there was no guest room available for them. And then we're going to go to Genesis 2. It says this: for the Lord, verse 15, the Lord God took man and he put him in the Garden of Eden to work it and to take care of it. Verse 18 says this: the Lord said, it is not good for man to be alone. I will make a helper suitable for him. And so I titled tonight, if you're taking notes, A Lonely Christmas. And so if you'd bow your heads and pray with me and pray for right now in this moment. God, we just thank you. And Holy Spirit, we invite you here. God, this is about you and for you. God, we roll out the red carpet for you. God, and we also say, come to do what you can do. Come to do, Jesus, in our hearts and in our lives, what only you can do. Work, give us faith, give us ambition, give us hope. And God, for those who are needing a touch on their lives tonight, would you just touch their life tonight, God? We love you and worship you. It's in Jesus' name we pray. And everyone said, amen. So when I was in college, when I went to college, I went to a Christian university where we all had Fridays off. Amen. It was amazing. And it was super awesome. And you could rearrange your classes just right, where you went to only classes on Tuesdays and Thursdays, or only classes on Mondays and Wednesdays. And if you could, were able to do that, you could literally snowboard 5 days a week. It was amazing. And so I probably goofed off and did a lot more of that around my junior year of college than anything else. And that year, it was early in the year that I was at Keystone, and I actually broke my arm, like, really early in the season. And I was like, no big deal, you know, I'm tough. And so, you know, I had to use, like, pencils to itch myself and, like, got into the whole groove of having a cast. It gets down to a half cast, and some friends of mine are going snowboarding after Christmas. It's Christmas break, and I think to myself, I'm down to a half cast. Like, I think I'm good to go, right? I think I'm okay. I think this can happen now. And they had some friends come in from Iowa, and I'm like, awesome, even better, the more the merrier, let's go. So we go up to Breckenridge. We have an incredible day, super fun. It's the end of the day, and mind you, I have not snowboarded all season because I've had a broken arm. And we get up to the top of the park at Breckenridge, and normally, in a normal year, it probably wouldn't have been an issue, or I wouldn't have had an issue, but I hadn't snowboarded, like, all year. And we're sitting at the top of, and has anybody ever done something really dumb to impress the opposite sex? Like, just so stupid. And so I look, this is a true story, as sure as I stand here. There were some fellas in the group. I am married to the only fella that matters now. But before this, there were some fellas in the group, and I was thinking to myself, I was looking at a couple of them, and I was like, okay, well, you know, I'm going to show off a little bit. And so this was my exact words to them. I said, hey, guys, I said, let me pace the jumps for you. My exact phrase. And what I was saying in that moment was, let me show you how it's done, okay? And at this point, there are three separate jumps, consecutive jumps, and this is pretty typical of the Breck Park, where they have like a 5-foot table, 10-foot table, 15-foot table up top, and it's like this flat space before you go down to the bottom of the jump. And so I say, let me pace the jumps for you, and I like take off down to you know, get into the park. So I hit the first jump, totally fine, and I totally remember it. Hit the second jump, don't quite remember it. Hit the third jump, and apparently what happened at that point was something pretty catastrophic, okay? Because when I wake up, there's this medic named Amy standing above me, and a bunch of the guys that I was trying to impress also standing around me. One of them said, you looked like a dead fish. So I was like, not impressive to him, okay? And she's asking me questions like, what's your name? right? And do you know who your mom is? And I'm like, oh, okay, this is awful, right? I had broken my collarbone. I had bruised ribs. I had rebroken my arm in the cast, if you can believe it. I had fractured my pelvis in four places, and I had a huge concussion, like a really bad one. They thought I had brain damage. I might, even to this day, right? And so we go to the ICU. I'm in the ICU for 4 days, and when I finally get out, I'm in the hospital for the next 10 days. And while I'm in the hospital, I'm 21 years old, right? It should be the highlight of my life is New Year's Eve, right? But that year, I remember laying in a bed, and I'm all by myself. My folks had gone home. I'm laying in a bed, and every muscle in my body hurt, every bone in my body hurt. I remember watching this little tiny TV in the corner of the room, the New York City festivities, and I remember just feeling, like, very alone. And all of a sudden, I hear this, like, gaggle of females coming down the hall, like, you know how girls, when we're together, we're like, you know, and I was like coming down the hall, and it's four of my best friends from when I was to like 10 years old on, and they've got hats, and they've got like part, you know, those part, the, what do you think, the blower things, they've got those, they've got the glasses that say, you know, like 2007, 2008 or whatever, you know, and they come into the room, and they're like, you know, Happy New Year's, Jess, and we sit down, and like they hang out with me, they joke about my catheter, you know what I mean, like it was like, it's like those kind of friends, like the best kind of friends that you can possibly have, amen, and at some point, you know, they climb into bed with me, and we all just kind of sit there, and we watch the ball drop together. They're 21 years old, they should be having the night of their life, and what they did instead was come and hang out with me, and when they left at the end of, you know, the ball dropping, and, you know, us being like, that was awesome, that was so cool, and they all go home, I remembered feeling like my body was strengthened, and I remembered feeling like the rest of my stay was just fine. Like, I didn't even notice the pain anymore. And I realized a couple of things. I realized that, one, I had some really good friends. I also realized that my healing wasn't going to happen in isolation. Because we were made for one another. You were made for somebody else. You were made for others. And others were made for you. There is power in presence. There is power in the presence of other people. And if you are looking in your Bibles, and we just read Genesis chapter 2, this is the creation account. What you need to understand about the creation account, believers, people who are investigating God online, when you read the creation account, what you are reading about is you are reading the way that God originally intended life to be. You are reading about the way he originally designed life to be. And this is important because it's the only way we can understand what his heart actually meant when he created us. It's the only way we know what he actually had in mind. Let me tell you what I mean. When archaeologists are looking at pottery, or they're looking at pieces of pottery, and they'll have a piece of pottery that will have like maybe some writing on it or some art on it or whatever, they'll only have these broken, fragmented pieces to work from. But they now have these computer programs where they can kind of piece together a little bit of what they think the bowl looked like or the pot looked like or whatever. And these computer programs can generate images of what this piece of pottery looked like in all of its glory and in its ornateness and in its beauty, the way that it was originally intended to be. And when we're reading Genesis 1 and Genesis 2, what you need to understand, if you're investigating God tonight, if you've walked with God for a really long time tonight, is that we are living in a broken and in a fragmented reality of what God originally intended. That this is not even close to what he had in mind. But when you read Genesis 1 and you read Genesis 2, what you are getting a picture of is the way that our creator, our artist, the way he designed us to be. And so God creates the heavens and the earth, and he separates land from sky. He separates water from land. He creates vegetation, right? He creates animals. He creates sea animals. I can't wait to see a whale. Like, he creates, gosh, if you need a break from the reality of life right now, just like get into the Instagram dump of whales and otters and fish. Like, just spend hours there. So good for your heart. So good for your brain. And then he creates man. Our God creates a human being. And mind you, they have perfect union. Adam and God have perfect union, meaning this. If Adam wants to play chess, he can play it with God. If he wants to play Fortnite, he can play it with God. If he wants to have, if he has a question about life, he can ask God. God literally walked with Adam. They had perfect union. And so listen, church, listen, One City, if God's intention were that you to do life just you and God, mano y mano, a solo project with just you and Jesus, you and the Father, then God would have stopped there, but he doesn't say that. He boldly proclaims this in Genesis 2. Then the Lord said, remind, this is before the fall, before the fracture, before the brokenness. The Lord God said, it is not good for man to be alone. I have read this scripture 100 times, and it baffles me. God's creation in all its glory, in its original glory, could have just been us and God. And he boldly says, that's not right. That's not good. It's not how I wanted it. This isn't my original intent. And so he puts Adam to sleep, and he makes a female. He makes the very first friendship, the very first relationship in all of history. We were made for each other. We were made for each other. And that's my first point tonight, is we were made for each other. Adam and Eve had a perfect relationship, which I know for some of us who argue over how to load the dishwasher, like this is hard to fathom, right? Perfect relationship, perfect union, perfect in their submission to one another, in their humility towards one another. And it was because they were made in the image of God. God says this in Genesis 1. Then God said, let us make man in our image, according to our likeness. Let us rule over the fish of the sea and over the birds of the air and the sky, over the cattle, over all the earth, over every creeping thing that creeps on the earth. And so he says over and over again, God is saying, our. Let us make them in our. Let us make them in our. What God is actually saying is we're going to make them like us, meaning the triune God. One person, three expressions. Father, Son, Holy Spirit. It was the very first small group, okay? God in and of himself actually had everything that he needs. But God in and of himself, listen, church, is a relational being. He is a relational being. He had this amazing relational community with himself, if you can imagine. And he said, let us make human beings just like that. Just like us. Let us make them in our image. And so he creates human beings, to which you might say, well, that's all well and good. Maybe we were made for one another way back then, Jess, but does that even apply today? I mean, it's 2020. Get a hint. I can be by myself anytime I want, anywhere I want to go, right? Well, the original church was the same way because it was made in God's likeness. It was made in God's image. It says this in Acts 4. The multitude of them believed. So this is the very first church. They were of one heart and of one soul. Neither of them said that they should possess the things that they possessed as their own, but all of them had these things in common. God says, I'm going to make them like me, and boom, he creates human beings. So relational. And when the very first church was born, I would argue that one of the chief characteristics of the original church in all of its glory was that it was profoundly, deeply relational. Ecclesia means an assembly of people. That's the Greek word for church. It means a group of people heading towards one purpose. It is a group of human beings, a like-mindedness, a like-heartedness. We were made for each other, which is interesting because in 2020, for the last 60 years, we have been trending towards this thing called individualism. I read a book a few years ago called Bowling Alone, and it's about basically the decline in community in America from 1955 until today. And it attributes the decline in our community to a couple of different things. Number one, the pressure of having a two-income households, and the fact that neighborhoods are no longer really neighborhoods, that we don't know how to neighbor because of the pressure of having two incomes. the electronic era and the dawn of the electronic era, right? Like, why do I need community when I can just tell everyone about myself? Why do I need to be known when I can just be shown? You know what I mean? Like, that is what we are living in right now. But the chief thing that this author argues that is contributing to us not having community the way that they did maybe in 1955 is the rise and the value of this thing called individualism. I mean, if you think about it, 60 years ago, 50 years ago, if you were going to work out, you would go to the neighborhood rec center, right? And you would play racquetball with someone else, right? If you wanted to recreate, you would play tennis with someone else. Now we have personal in-home gyms, Pelotons, right? If you wanted to do business 60 years ago, you did it over lunch and handshakes. Now we have personal in-home offices with personal computers and personal cell phones. We have personal in-home chefs if we're rich, and we have personal in-home theaters. And so the only reason that we go to be around other people isn't really to even have community with other people. It is just to go and be around them. They call it the Starbucks effect, where you go to Starbucks, right, and you just want to be around other people, but you don't want to be bothered. Like, don't ask me anything. Like, I'm here just working by myself. You know what I mean? Like the Starbucks effect. And so we were made for one another. We were made for one another, but for the last 60 years, we have been trending towards this loneliness. And if we are being honest tonight, watching online, here in person, there is this deep-seated feeling within us that we think that the best way that we can live our lives is actually unto ourselves, that if we are alone, if it's a solo project, if we're flying solo, this might be the best way for us to live life. And listen, I don't blame you, because you are living in a culture right now that is screaming to you, it's all about you. And so why would you believe anything different? We were made for each other. And yet we're together in our aloneness. Amen? One heart, one soul. But we'd rather be by ourselves. And then 2020 happened. And it's no longer our choice if we're by ourselves. Now we have to be by ourselves. Now we're being asked to be by ourselves. And if I think there's one profoundly redeeming quality about 2020, it's that it's showing us that isolation isn't all it's cracked up to be, that individualism isn't all that it's promised, and that isolation comes with some costs. Amen? Isolation comes with some costs. It says this in Proverbs 18. It says, whoever isolates himself seeks his own desire. He breaks out against all sound judgment. When we are isolated, we become unsound and we become unstable. The second law of thermodynamics, the way that systems operate, the way that galaxies operate, the second law of thermodynamics says that the more isolated a system becomes, the more increased it becomes in its entropy. Entropy is the degree of instability and chaos. This applies to galaxies. This applies to solar systems. This applies to human beings. The more isolated a thing becomes, the more unstable it becomes, the more uncertain it becomes, the more chaotic it becomes. It's science. And yet, we're more alone now than ever. We know this to be true, right? Because we've made some of the worst decisions of our lives in isolation, right? I mean, some of the most boneheaded decisions you have made, I have made, have come out of seasons where we are just by our lonesome, amen? And I love this verse. It says this in Proverbs 15. It says, plans fail for lack of counselor, but with many advisors, they succeed. We get off course when we are in isolation. There's another translation that says, when a man has a bunch of counselors around him, his plans are established. Listen, it is not good enough for us to be alone thinking thoughts about our lives on our own, right? We cannot advise ourselves about ourselves because we endlessly deceive ourselves about ourselves. We need somebody else speaking into our lives, someone who's honest and earnest, a group of people. Listen, if you care about your calling tonight, if you care about where God is taking you, if you care about the plans that he has for you in 2021, if you are praying for breakthrough, listen, it is not going to be enough that you try to maneuver that on your own. The Bible says a man in the presence of many counselors, a man's plans are established. The opposite of that is true. That if you have no one around you but yourself, your plans will not be established. And so we need each other. We were made for each other. A valid question to be asking ourselves this season is, does my walk with God, does my pursuit of God just involve me? Or does my pursuit of God involve other people? When I first became a believer, I went to a Christian university, and for some reason I thought it was more noble. True story, I don't know why I thought this, but I thought it was like more noble to try to do it on my own. I really did. And so I remember thinking, it's just you and me, God, and I did. I had a rich relationship even with the Holy Spirit back then, but I'd go on walks with God all by myself. I'd get alone with God all by myself. I'd spend time in the Word all by myself, and I kind of avoided Christian community, authentic Christian community where I was with other people and they knew me. I didn't go there. And I can honestly say some of the worst decisions, some of the most boneheaded decisions, some of the worst dating relationships of my life came out of that season. Why? Because no one was around me and no one knew me. I can show you who I am, but nobody really knows who I am. And I think that in this season, we are starting to realize, church, and praise God for this, that isolation is not all it's cracked up to be. And God, what I believe God is doing in this season is he is resetting in 2020. He is resetting our need for each other. He is resetting our need for one another, that we actually, what we consider a blessing now is completely different. He is resetting what we consider to be a blessing. What you consider to be a blessing in 2019 was a new pair of Nikes at Christmas. What you consider to be a blessing in 2020 is time with your Nana, amen? What you considered to be a blessing a year ago, listen, was maybe power tools or like new brushes for your makeup. Like, that's what you considered to be a blessing. That's what I considered to be a blessing. Now, it's the power of the presence of other people. We crave it. We need it. He is resetting what we need. And he's bringing us back to what he originally intended. And so it's like Christmas time, but the very first Christmas, I think, was a lonely Christmas. This is my read of scripture. There are people who argue differently. I think the first Christmas was a lonely Christmas. The first Christmas was lonely. I would invite you, One City Church, to spend some time in Advent. We have Advent readings on our Instagram. You can get Advent books online. You can find Advent Bible studies in your Bible app. But I would encourage you to spend time worshiping God and spending time with Jesus as we celebrate his birth, because it's the coming of our Savior. And so I was reading Luke 1, Luke 2. I would encourage you to read those texts. I was reading Matthew 1 this week. And as I was consuming God's word, I was just very struck by the aloneness of Mary and the aloneness of Joseph. It says this in Luke 2. In those days, Caesar Augustus issued a decree, a census that should be taken throughout the entire Roman world. This was the first census that took place while Quirinius was the governor of Syria. And everyone went to their own town to register. It is wild to me that the very first Christmas started with a government mandate. It is crazy to me. The very first Christmas began with a government mandate. Caesar wants to know. Caesar's like, I'm hot, but I want to know how many people are in my kingdom. And so he's like, let's count them. I'm not going to count them. Have other people count them. You're not going to count them. Have them go to their hometowns, right? Like everybody has to go to where they were born so that they can be counted, so Caesar can feel good about himself. And so everyone travels from their hometown, or travels from where they're living to where they are from. And the Bible says that there was no room for Mary and Joseph at the inn. It says this: she wrapped him in clothes and placed him in a manger because there was no guest room available for them. This is probably a different birth experience than what Mary was imagining, than what Joseph was imagining. They were in isolation. And when I think about even Mary's pregnancy, if you know this story, Elizabeth was Mary's cousin, right? Elizabeth gets pregnant with John the Baptist. This is crazy. It's amazing. It's a miracle that she's pregnant. Mary comes to see her cousin, and John, in utero, recognizes Jesus in utero. He's the very first one to recognize the fetus to lead us, as Levi Lesko says. Save the babies. The fetus to lead us, and he recognizes him. The Holy Spirit falls on Elizabeth. It's a beautiful moment. But then the Bible says this after that. It says, Mary stayed there for 3 months. Now, Mary was pregnant from the Holy Spirit. Okay, imagine her telling Joseph. Now, imagine Mary trying to tell anybody else that she's pregnant. Joseph had an angel visit him, right? He's like, oh, yeah, Mary, sure. You know, right. And then an angel comes and he's like, no, Joseph, she's pregnant from God. It's God's baby. But imagine Mary trying to tell anybody else. Like, there's no Instagram posts. You know what I mean? There's no one to celebrate with Mary about this baby. There's nobody to say good job. Single mothers, you may feel like, man, it is so difficult to tell other people that I had this child. Listen, God's most blessed woman understands your plight. He knows what it's like to not have people celebrating you, to not have people celebrating with you. She stayed with Elizabeth for 3 months. And I bet it felt a little bit lonely. Both my sister and I have been pregnant during COVID. We had our son in August. My sister is due this month, so be praying for her that the delivery is wonderful with her husband and that they get to meet their son and it's all smooth. Would covet your prayers, truly. But my sister asked a few months ago, she was like, hey, do you want a baby shower? And I was like, I do, yeah. I want baby clothes. Let's do this. You know, like, let's have a baby shower. And so she goes, great. And so we start planning the whole thing, and the baby shower happens. And because of where we're at right now in society, because of the pandemic, because of everything that's happening and people not feeling comfortable and whatever, the baby shower came and I bought a dress for it and I felt so pretty. And I'm not saying this to make you feel bad for me, but I only had one friend come. And so I got into my car after it was all over, and I just cried. Because these are the moments that we're meant to share with one another. These are the moments that we are meant to have with one another. These are the moments that are blessed because we have joy with one another. These are the moments that we share one another's burdens. Some of you, it's been a little bit of a different year. Some of you, you're getting married right now. It's been a different year. Some of you, you've had funerals this year. It's been a different year. You've had Zoom birthday parties and drive-by birthday parties, and the things that we were meant to do together is just different. It's been a little bit lonely. And I can feel the isolation. There were no sip and sees. There were no baby showers for Mary. I can feel the isolation in Luke 1 and Luke 2. I can feel it in Matthew 1. There's nobody there. And what's crazy about the very first Christmas is that Jesus is showing us almost that in his birth, he's showing us what he is being born into is the scenario that he is going to heal. He's showing us the scenario that he came to heal. At the beginning of this service, Alisa and Ariel, they're incredible. So grateful for them. They sang the song, O Come Emmanuel. This was written in the 8th century, maybe the 12th century. It was a Latin vesper. Veni, Veni, Emmanuel is what the song sings. And it's based off of this scripture, the prophecy in Isaiah 7. It says this, therefore the Lord himself will give you a sign. Behold, the virgin shall conceive and bear a son and shall be called his name Emmanuel. Okay, this was written 740 years before the birth of Jesus, that Jesus would be born, our Savior would be born unto a virgin. If you ever doubt your faith or struggle with your faith, please study the prophecies that are only fulfilled solely and uniquely in Jesus the Christ. 740 years, that's three times the age of America. That's a lot of time, y'all. And then the prophecy is finally fulfilled. an angel comes to Joseph before Mary has the baby. And I'm sure that Joseph is like, yo. I mean, it says he's thinking about getting rid of her quietly because he's an honorable man. He's like, okay, she's pregnant, not my kid. You know what I mean? Like, he knows. He knows how it works. And an angel comes to him and he says, no, Joseph, this baby is born of God. And you are going to name him Emmanuel, which means God with us. God with us. God holding us. God touching us. God coming close to us. God, not God far away, not God far off, God with. This is the miracle of Christmas. But little did Joseph know, y'all, that he was about to go with Mary to his hometown and have a baby in isolation. And then after that, Herod discovers that there is a baby that is born in the Jews that is going to be called the King of the Jews. And he's so angry and upset that he basically makes a proclamation throughout all of Israel that any baby that's 2 years old and younger, that's a baby boy, should be put to death. An angel comes to Joseph again, says, get out of here, and they go to Egypt. The first 2 years of Jesus' life, Mary and Joseph are in a foreign country with a foreign language, with foreign customs that they don't understand. They are so alone. And when they come back to Israel, when they're finally allowed to come back to Israel after Herod has passed away and it's safe, there's no babies that are Jesus's age. So alone, y'all. This is the very first Christmas, and I'm juxtapositioning the fact that Mary and Joseph are riding on a donkey to Bethlehem to have this baby in isolation with the fact that Mary is carrying the baby that is named God with us. And it's almost like God wants us to understand, listen, the Christmas story is about him being born into the scenario that he came to heal. He's showing us who he came for, that he came for the lonely. In Psalm 68, it says this: sing to God, sing praise of his name, extol him who rides on the clouds, rejoice before him. His name is the Lord. He is a father to the fatherless, a defender of widows, a God in his holy dwelling. God sets the lonely in families. Lonely here means solitary, it means only, it means alone. And according to scripture, God is a father to those who have no father. He himself will be their dad. To those who are widowed, to those who are without husbands, he is their defender. To those who are lonely, the Bible says he gives them an actual family. He gives them a home. Jesus came for the lonely. And that's my last point. Jesus came for the lonely. Having Houston has been such a gift this year. It's truly been a gift in 2020 to have our son. He is so beautiful and so bright-eyed and so handsome. And he looks at me, y'all, as if I hung the moon. Every time, for those of you who have had babies, for those of you who haven't had babies yet, let me just give you a wonderful clue, is that when they look at you, they like describe how much they love you with their eyes. It's incredible. I don't even understand it. It's the most amazing thing. And he'll look at me, and sometimes I think to myself, man, I wish I was half the person that Houston thought I was. You know, like, I wish I was, like, half the human, that half the mom that Houston thinks I am. Because he looks at me, and he's like, hey, and he's so smiley, and he's so trusting. He's such a gift during this season. And I think about Mary and Joseph not having anyone around them, but they got to have Jesus. And I think about Mary and Joseph traveling to Egypt and not knowing anybody and not knowing where to go and not understanding the culture or the people, but they had Jesus. The very first Christmas that they didn't have, you know, people stamping his foot on something and making, you know, showering with gifts, although the Magi came and they did have a baby shower at one point. Super awesome, right? But in that first Christmas, it was just a little bit lonely, but they had Jesus. Jesus sets the lonely in families. And I think some of us, we already know, right, that this Christmas is going to be a little different. Some of us already know what's going to be happening this Christmas for us, that we've felt it all year. We've been alone all year. For some of us, it's palpable. We can feel the loneliness. And what I think Jesus wants to say tonight is that I came to get close when others back away. that Jesus meets us when other people back off. That Jesus is with us when others aren't as close. God is with us. Jesus' first miracle in the book of Matthew, he heals a leper. I think you know this, but if you don't, Jesus is able to heal with his word. He's able to heal with his mouth. He's able to heal by speaking. We read this story a few weeks ago, but he healed Lazarus by talking to him. In Matthew, he decides to touch the leper. Because Jesus touches the parts that other people back away from. In the book, with a woman at the well, for those of you who know her story, she was married multiple times. She had multiple lovers. She had a long list and was rejected by pretty much women folk, right? She was the girl that everybody talked about. And Jesus comes to her and he gets to know her. He converses with her because Jesus embraces what others throw away. With Mary and Joseph, he comes close. Jesus is born into the situation that he is going to heal. And so if everybody can stand in here tonight, I think that God wants to heal us from loneliness in 2020. And I think there's two types of loneliness he wants to heal specifically tonight. One is a self-inflicted loneliness. And we've been using the pandemic in the last couple years of our lives as an excuse, really, for us doing life on our own, for us doing life by ourselves. Nobody needs to know me. I don't need to know anybody else, right? It is a self-inflicted isolation. And what I think God wants to say tonight is I can heal this, but I need your permission and I need your help. Okay, it's not going to be enough for you to just worship tonight. You're actually going to have to text somebody. Like, you're actually going to have to reach out to somebody. You're actually going to have to invite somebody in to what's going on. Amen. Right now. A self-inflicted loneliness, a self-inflicted isolation. But then there's a whole nother loneliness that God wants to heal tonight, and it's an unelected loneliness. Yeah. It's loneliness you didn't ask for. It's loneliness you didn't want. Jesus wants you to know that in this season, he comes close to the areas and to the parts of you that others push away, that he comes close to the places that are in isolation. So with every head bowed and every eye closed, I just have two questions. Number one, maybe you've been living in a self-inflicted loneliness and you don't let people in. The pandemic has been something that just kind of exasperated that. And it's something you want to confess. And if that's you tonight, would you just raise your hand and say, God, I've done this to myself. I need community. I was made for someone else. Someone else was made for me. I was made for other people. Other people were made for me. God, heal this of me. There's a second group of people, and it's for people that don't know Jesus. You don't know the man who comes close, the Savior who comes close and heals the parts of us that are isolated. And if that's you, and if you would like to know the healing miracle of knowing your Savior, of accepting his salvation, receiving his life. If that's you, if you're in the chat room, raise a hand. You can raise a hand in here now. Amen. God, we thank you for your salvation. God, you say that if we confess with our mouths that we are sinners, that we have nothing apart from you, God, you say that you would heal us and you would save us, God. Not only save us from our sins, but give us your life, Jesus. And for that, we thank you. And God, for every single person in here that has a self-inflicted loneliness, watching online, that has an unelective loneliness, God, I ask that you would come in and heal us tonight. God, may we not leave 2020 the same way that we went in. God, may we hunger to be what you created us to be, that we were made for one another. God, we love you. It's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen.